G'day everyone, Tim here from Mountain Bikes Direct. I'm one of the founders.
And I'm Michael.
Michael, one of the other founders. Today we're just going to run through a couple of things on bikes. Having done some four-wheel driving over the last couple of days as well, we've noticed there's just heaps of similarities between four-wheel driving and getting out on the mountain bikes. So we'll run through a few things today. So tire pressures, suspension setup, and
Some line choice.
So tire pressures are the most important thing on your bike and the easiest thing to adjust as well. There's no hard and fast rules around what pressure you should run.
Yeah, there's just heaps of factors you've got to consider when setting your tire pressures. But just ignore what it says on the side of your tire, because it says like 35 to 60 PSI, which is pretty much not good for most people.
Yep. We're going to run through a bunch of reasons why you can do it better than what the tire says. And there's no, like, we can't say you should run this or that, because there's all these different factors and you need to kind of work it out based on those factors.
Well, I mean, we probably should talk about what tire pressures we do run. Not that these are right or wrong, but for the type of terrain, for our body weight, and for our riding style, I typically probably aim for around 18 on the front, 23 on the back.
Yeah.
But I'm 70 kilos and I typically run like a 2.4 on the front, 2.3 on the back. And that's me.
Yep. Yeah, I'm a bit chunkier than what Michael is, so I typically run inserts in my tires and I'll run 23 on the front and 26 on the back, or thereabouts, just depending on the day and how hard you're pushing as well. You know, if you're riding, really want to push hard and ride fast, you often need to just up those pressures a touch so you're not blowing through and cutting tires. So with your tires, you can use your thumbs to test how much pressure's in them if you don't have a gauge handy. So you just want to come to the tire, give it a good push, and see how that feels. So you're going to want to push on the top of the tire. Just if you do have inserts and you're pushing on the side, you're going to be pushing against those inserts, and it's going to give you a false kind of thumb reading as to what you've got. So what I like to do is I'll use my top proper tire pressure gauge to check how much pressure's in there, and then I'll just use my thumbs as well to kind of fine tune my thumbs so I get a bit of a gauge of how much pressure's in there from that thumb feel and what that relates to. So that'll be a big help when you're actually out on the tracks and you don't have a proper gauge handy. You can just tune those thumbs in and see how you feel. So the other one you can do is the kind of lateral push. So if you just turn your bike, your front wheel sideways, and just give it a good push, and you're looking at the ground to see how much that tire is rolling. It is rubber after all, and so you do want some movement. You just don't want to be able to push your rim into the ground or see that whole tire move underneath. So that's one factor, is the volume of the tire based on the width and the wheel size.
There's wheel diameter and also tire width. So if I'm running like a narrower tire, typically used for like cross country riding or endurance riding, that might be, you know, a 2.0 or a 2.1. But if you look at the other extreme where you're talking about downhill racing, it's usually 2.5 to 2.7.
Very similar to a four-wheel drive, you know. Some tires are on a thinner casing and you need to run higher pressure than other tires. Like, you know, your muddies tend to have a really thick sidewall and you can run lower pressures on them.
That's because, I guess you also got to think about your weight and your riding style as well. So if you're a lighter rider, or if you've got a 15-year-old kid or something, you should typically get the lightest tire you can find, because it'd be quicker to accelerate, easier to ride up hills. But if you're over 100 kilos and you like to ride really rocky stuff, you probably want to run a downhill casing, that the heaviest casing you can find, because like cutting holes in your tires.
Another factor is nowadays you can get inserts that go into your tire to almost make the casing stronger and absorb a bit better. So you can run lower pressures because you've got kind of this foam layer inside your tire to absorb, and you're not going to be pinching that tire or tube if you're running a tube, which is also another factor. If you're running tubes or tubeless, you're going to be running different pressures as well. Tubeless, you can typically run a bit softer because you don't have a tube to pinch. Whereas with tubes, you do need to up it another few PSI over what you'd run tubeless.
One interesting thing is that you can actually, if you run heaps of pressure, you actually increase the chance of cutting your tire, because if you can imagine like a balloon, right? You've got a balloon that's really like deflated, it's really hard to pop. But if you've got a balloon that's at its max, it's really easy to pop. So you kind of got to balance that as well. So there's different types of flats you can have. So cutting a sidewall of your tire you actually reduce that chance by having it lower. But pinching, if you've got a tube,
yeah,
you, the only way to stop that is by increasing your pressure. So
for sure,
it's always a bit of a balance. To find out what's the right tire pressure for yourself, you probably have to experiment with it yourself. So I typically, like if I'm setting tire pressures for my kids, for example, like I've got an 8-year-old and a 6-year-old, when I watch them ride, I kind of watch and see what their tires are doing. So if they're cornering hard and the tire's squirming under them, you increase the pressure. But for the most part, like, I mean, they're 20 kilos or something, so, you know, that I probably put 10 PSI in there. But if it also, like, on, if you go to like a bike park and you're doing lots of jumps and berms, there's a lot of kind of G-forces on your bike, and therefore you've got to run high pressures, otherwise you'll be like, you'll be swapped, like squirming.
Yeah, your tire's going to be rolling off the rim.
So, and if you're running tubeless, that means you're burping your tire, so your tire actually,
yeah, the bead's pulling off the rim and air's escaping and you're dropping even more pressure and it's become more prone to that happening.
So I guess the best way to do it is to probably just guess and check, really, like, just,
yeah, keep all the parameters the same and just, you know, don't change tires and inserts and tire widths, just change your pressures to work out what combination works best for that setup and go from there. And terrain plays a massive part in pressures as well, like Michael was saying. There's, you know, if you're riding really rough stuff, you want to try and get that pressure as low as you can just to get grip. But if it is really fast and you're really slapping berms hard, you do need to get that pressure up a bit to stop that tire roll. And it just feels horrible as well if your tire is squirming underneath you.
Totally. And you can have, like, even like we always said, like if you've got a $10,000 bike, like top of the shelf bike, if your pressures are wrong, it's not going to ride well. So
yeah,
it's probably the most important thing to get right.
Absolutely. And it's the easiest thing to
yeah, it doesn't cost anything.
Yeah. So the next thing we're going to talk about is suspension settings. After your tires, suspension is probably the next most important thing. So you've got several adjustments on most modern mountain bikes. You've got your compression adjustment, your rebound adjustment, and your air pressure.
And so your air pressure is essentially your spring rate. So most mountain bikes nowadays have their air sprung. There is some coil options, and we won't cover that today, but most bikes are air sprung, and essentially you've got to get your air springs right because that's what supports your weight. And if it's too soft, your geometry is going to be out, the bike's going to be unstable, you might be tagging pedals. But if it's too hard, you're not going to use all your travel, and it's the,
yeah,
you know, you want that's the point of suspension travel, is to use it. So
yeah, exactly the same as on a four-wheel drive. If your spring rate's not right, you're in a world of hurt to begin with. After your spring rate, you'd move to your rebound as being your most important setting. So rebound, once the fork compresses, is the speed it's coming back up at. And you want that to be just nice and controlled. You don't want it to feel like a pogo stick. So winding that knob in will slow the fork down. So again, it's quite personal as to how fast you want to run it, but you just want that nice and controlled.
And the rebound, the spring rate's actually determines, is a key factor in how fast the suspension recoils as well, because if you've got a lot of spring force, it'll come back force for the same unit of rebound dampening. So
yep,
usually you set your air pressures first. And to do that, I typically, as a starting point, the guide on the back of your forks or in your manual,
yep,
is typically pretty good.
Pretty good,
I find.
Yep.
And your rear sag, you're typically aiming between 25 to 30%,
yep,
depending on the bike. There's not that much difference between them. You can have a play around with it.
Yeah.
Also got to think about your tracks as well.
Yeah, and a bit of personal preference in there as well.
Yep. So I guess, yeah, so usually you can use the O-rings on your shock. You push that all the way home, sit on your bike, and if you're just doing it rough, you can eyeball it and say, that's
yep,
about 30%, that's about 25%.
Yep.
I'm happy with that. Increase it, decrease it as needed. You can leave your shock connected to your rear shock, so you leave your shock pump connected to adjust that.
Yeah.
And then once you've got that dialed, you then set your fork, take your bike for a ride, push up and down on it, and just make sure your suspension's balanced. And once that's set, that's your basis for adjusting everything else.
For sure. And your final adjustment then is just compression adjustment. And that's, for most people, that's going to be more of a fine-tuning adjustment. So you'd start with it all the way off. And if you want to just slow the fork's compression. If you want to make it go through its travel slower, that's where you're going to wind compression on. So compression is also really helpful for like brake dive. If you feel it's just sinking through its travel a bit too fast, but you're not necessarily bottoming the fork out, so your spring rate is good, you can then use that compression adjuster just to help the fork sit up in its travel a bit higher. So with your rebound, you want it to be fast enough that it's...
that it can recover for the next bump.
Correct.
You also don't want it to be like too fast. So on the face of a jump, as you're bottoming out, it's starting to rebound and it'll send you over
kick
the bars.
You. Yep.
But then you also don't want it to be a pogo stick because rebound dampening does make your forks more controlled. So you've kind of got to tweak it to figure that out. One, how I usually set the rear is actually, once I've set my spring rate, I just jump on the bike and it goes down and it should come up and stop. It shouldn't go down, come up, and then go again. So that's not a bad guide.
Yeah, which is exactly the same as on a car or a four-wheel drive. You don't want it to be compressing and bouncing and then, you know, otherwise your rebound's too fast. So to check your pressure, typically top left of your fork, you've got a Schrader valve there, which you'll use a shock pump on to pump up. So most forks will have an O-ring on it, like this red one here. Normally you'll push that down to your seal and then go out for a ride. And as you ride, you'll see how much travel you're using. So this one's your compression adjuster. So you'll wind it in for more compression to make it go through its travel slower. By in, I mean clockwise. HSC is high speed compression and LSC is low speed compression. So your rebound adjuster is on the bottom right leg. You'll wind it in towards the turtle to go slower, to come back up slower. See how this one, when you push it down, it's coming back up nice and controlled. So your rear shock is exactly the same as your fork. You've got your O-ring on the shaft, compression adjuster is the blue one, red one is your rebound.
Suspension on a modern mountain bike is really amazing. It's really worth investing the 5 minutes setting up your compression, your rebound, and your spring rate to get the most out of it for a cracking day out on the trails.
All right, so the last thing we'll talk about today is line choice. To start with, you want to kind of pre-plan the corner that's coming up or the section that's coming up by making sure you're looking far enough ahead that things aren't just popping up on you.
So if you have your eyes down, which a lot of people do, typically your eyes drop, you start dragging your brakes, and you just can't process the track as it's coming towards you because you just can't see enough.
That's it. The second thing you're going to want to think about is which line you're going to take through the corner. So in most corners, not all, most corners, you're going to want to start as high as you can, hit that apex, and then exit outside as well.
So at a singular corner with a long exit, that's typically the best way. So on the worn trail, starting like just the racing line essentially on a F1 track. However, you've also got to consider the other corners that are after it. So you might change that depending, like you want to have the fastest exit for the section, not necessarily the singular corner is usually the best line.
Correct. So come in slower, exit fast is always the best way to ride.
Braking, when to brake, how to brake. So typically you want to do your braking before the corner. You can brake into the corner, but about halfway through the corner, you want to start then releasing your brakes because that's when your braking's complete and then your tires just grip a lot better when there's no brakes applied. And that's when you start to gain momentum out of the corner and your exit speed, I mean, that's saving you from pedaling really. So it saves you a lot of energy on a mountain bike.
So for descending, you'll have your seat nice and low so you can move the bike around between your legs. When you're leaning into a corner, if it's a banked up corner, you'll lean with the bike. If it's a flatter turn, you'll typically lean the bike, but not your body, to keep your body over the top of your tires contacting the ground.
I find like often you feel like you're leaning more than you are. So the best way to remind myself, I often find, is to drop your inside wrist to the ground. And that's a way to get a good lean on and make sure your tires really bite into the ground for a good exit.
So to recap, today we've touched on a few little things. So your tire pressures, your suspension settings, your line choice, and a tiny bit on cornering.
Hopefully that's a couple of tips that'll help you get more from your next ride.